Genesis chapter 22. Travel back in time with me, some 4,000 years. Abram was born in a godless city called Ur of the Chaldeans, right here. And at that time, God told Abram, when he was probably in his 60s or maybe even early 70s, that he and his wife Sarai were to go to Canaan. And God promised that there he would, from their descendants, bring about a great nation that would ultimately bless the entire world. Well, Abram and Sarai were childless at the time, so that seemed like a far reach for them. Well, they started out and they left Ur with his father, Terah, and his nephew, Lot. And they came this way because this is all desert. And so they followed the river and they got as far as Haran. And I don't know whether perhaps Terah had some physical problems, but they settled there in Haran until Abram was 75 years of age. And then his father died. So he and Sarai and Lot continued the trip to Canaan. And it was in that place, that region of the world, several centuries later, that a God-centered nation of Abram and Sarai's descendants, called Israel, would give birth to Jesus Christ, and Jesus would forever change the course of human history. Now, if you've been reading in your Bibles this week, you will note that God repeated, he renewed, he expanded his covenant with Abram on several occasions, wanting to make sure that Abram knew about this promise of his, that Abram's descendants would number more than the stars in the sky eventually. But it was not until Abram was 100 years of age and his wife Sarah was 90 that they finally had a son named Isaac. And then we come to Genesis chapter 22. Isaac is probably 18 to 25 years of age by this time. And God asked Abraham to do the unthinkable, to sacrifice his son Isaac. Now, what made that so strange was that prior to that, God had always forbidden the senseless taking of innocent human life. So why would God be asking Abraham to now sacrifice his son? And how could God fulfill this promise that he had made to Abraham and Sarah many times to make of their descendants a great nation if Isaac were now dead and both of them were well over 100 years of age? Our focus this morning is not so much on Abraham's remarkable faith, as great as it was, but on God's unfathomable faithfulness. So if you have your Bibles, we're going to begin reading from Genesis chapter 22 and verse 1. Sometime later, God tested Abraham's faith. Abraham, God called, "Yes, here I am. Take your son, your only son, yes, Isaac, whom you love so much, and go to the land of Moriah. Go and sacrifice him as a burnt offering on one of the mountains, which I will show you." The next morning, Abraham got up early. He saddled his donkey and took two of his servants with him, along with his son Isaac. Then he chopped wood for a fire for a burnt offering and set out for the place God had told him about. On the third day of their journey, Abraham looked up and saw the place in the distance. "Stay here with the donkey," Abraham told the servants. "The boy and I will travel a little farther. We will worship there, and then we will come right back." So Abraham placed the wood for the burnt offering on Isaac's shoulders, while he himself carried the fire and the knife. As the two of them walked on together, Isaac turned to Abraham and he said, "Father." "Yes, my son." "We have the fire and we have the wood, but where is the sheep for the burnt offering?" "God will provide a sheep for the burnt offering, my son," Abraham answered, and they both walked on together. When they arrived at the place where God had told him to go, Abraham built an altar and arranged the wood on it. Then he tied his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. And Abraham picked up the knife to kill his son as a sacrifice. At that moment, the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven. Abraham, Abraham, yes, here I am, Abraham replied. Don't lay a hand on the boy, the angel said. Do not hurt him in any way, for now I know that you truly fear God. You have not withheld from me even your son, your only son. Then Abraham looked up and saw a ram caught by its horns in a thicket. So he took the ram and sacrificed it as a burnt offering in place of his son. And Abraham named the place Yahweh Yireh, which means the Lord will provide. And to this day, people still use that name as a proverb. On the mountain of the Lord, it will be provided. If you take out the outline there on the inside of your bulletins, first thing we see is this. God is able to provide all we need. If you turn with me back to Genesis chapter 18, Abraham entertains three heavenly visitors in Genesis 18. And one of them says to Abraham in verse 10, I will return to you about this time next year, and your wife Sarah will have a son. Well, folks, by that time, Sarah is 89 years of age. So you can understand why she might be a little bit skeptical. She kind of laughs to herself. That's impossible. Can you imagine, ladies, at 89 years of age, going through 9 months of pregnancy and delivering at the age of 90? The Lord asks a question at that point, a question that he has been answering in the affirmative over and over ever since. Is anything too hard for the Lord? If you look in Genesis 17 and verse 1, God said to Abram, I am El Shaddai. I am God Almighty. I am the God who can do anything. A few centuries later, God would ask the same question of Jeremiah that he asked of Abraham. I am the Lord, the God of all the peoples of the world. Is anything too hard for me? Jeremiah's response really is one that we should agree with. O sovereign Lord, you have made the heavens and the earth by your great power. Nothing is too hard for you. When Mary asked the angel how it was that she, a virgin, could deliver a son, the angel assured her, nothing is impossible with God. When Jesus told his disciples that it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than it is for a rich person to enter into the kingdom of heaven, his disciples were flabbergasted. Well, if that's the case, then who can enter into the kingdom of heaven? Jesus looked straight at his disciples with a look that would not let them go. With man, this is impossible. But not with God. Nothing is too hard for God. All things are possible with God. Job told God, I know you can do anything. No one can stop you. When the pagan king Nebuchadnezzar threatened to throw three Hebrew men named Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego into a blazing, hot, fiery furnace unless they bowed down and worshiped him, he asked them, what God will be able to rescue you from my power when you are in the fiery furnace? You know how they responded? If we are thrown into that blazing hot furnace, the God whom we serve is able to save us. He will rescue us from your power. King David proclaimed, yours, O Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the victory, and the majesty. Everything in the heavens and on earth is yours. We adore you as the one who is over all things. Riches and honor come from you alone, for you rule over everything. Power and might are in your hand. It is at your discretion that people are made great and given strength. The Apostle Paul prayed that you will begin to understand the incredible greatness of God's power for we who believe in him. This is the same mighty power, he said, that raised Christ from the dead and seated him in the place of honor at God's right hand in the heavenly realms. Glory to God, Paul said, because he is able to do exceedingly abundantly above anything that we ask, anything that we even imagine asking God to do. My question is this. If God was able to create the heavens and the earth with his spoken word, is there anything God cannot do? our God is able to provide for our financial and material needs, whatever they might be. Our God is able to provide for us peace in the midst of our worst storms. Our God is able to provide direction when we are undeniably, hopelessly lost. Our God is able to provide strength at the very moment we are weak and ready to give up. Our God is able to provide us deliverance from every temptation, victory over any trial, give us authority over any evil. Our God has not saved us from sin and redeemed us from hell so that we might be afraid, so that we might fear and be timid before our enemies. Our God has given us a spirit of power, a spirit of love, and a spirit of self-control. The whole Bible affirms that God is on our side. The whole Bible tells us that God is able to do anything, that God is able to provide for any spiritual need, physical need, emotional need, mental need, and social need that you and I will ever have. Now we also see in our text, God is willing to provide all we need. Abraham was a great man of faith. I mean, that's why he was chosen by God to be the father of the Israelite nation, the ancestor of the Messiah. Paul would testify of Abraham in the New Testament. Abraham never wavered in believing God's promise. Abraham was absolutely convinced that God was able to do anything he promised. The Hebrew writer also affirmed it was by faith that Abraham offered Isaac as a sacrifice. Abraham assumed that if Isaac died, God was able to bring him back to life again. But even though Abraham was a great man of faith, and with a great faith, he wasn't a perfect individual. He had his flaws as well. If you've read through the scriptures this past week, you will have noted that his treatment of Hagar, Sarai's servant, who bore Abram a son, could hardly be classified as winning him the Father of the Year award. On two different occasions, Abraham asked his wife Sarai if perhaps she might lie to different individuals in order to spare his life, but putting her life in great danger. And yet, the good news is this: God is willing to use Abraham. In spite of his flaws, because of his great faith, God was willing to provide whatever Abraham needed so that Abraham could do and Abraham could be what God wanted him to. And I'm here to tell you this morning, what was true of Abraham is true of you and me as well. Though we're all flawed and we all sin, by faith, God is willing to use us. God is willing to provide whatever we need to fulfill His plans in our lives. You see, whether you know it or not, God has a plan for your life. And God has a plan for my life. You and I are part of God's story. There are lives that He wants to use you and me to change. Lives He wants to use us to impact. Lives that He wants to use us to touch for Him. And if we trust God in the same way that Abraham trusted in God, God is willing to provide whatever we need to fulfill His plan in our lives, even as He did in Abraham's life. Why do you think God's story has been recorded for us? Why is it necessary for us to read His story several centuries later? Is it just because as we read through here, there's a lot of nice stories in there? Is that why? Listen, God's story has been preserved for us all of these centuries, so that you and I can find hope and encouragement in our lives by seeing what God has already done in other people's lives throughout human history. I mean, think about this. Where does anything we have come from? Where does our intelligence come from? Where does our talents and our abilities come from? Where do our open doors and our opportunities come from? Where does our resolve and our strength, where does it come from? James says it all comes from God. Paul asks the question, what do you have that God hasn't given you? And if all you have is from God, why do you boast as though anything you've accomplished, you did it on your own? The Bible says the eyes of the Lord are searching the whole earth right now because God wants to strengthen those whose hearts are fully committed to Him. Yes, even today, God is looking for people that He can strengthen, that He can use. People whose hearts are fully committed to Him. Not only is God able to provide whatever we need to do His will, but God is wanting to provide whatever we need to do His will. Leprosy was a terrible disease in Jesus' day. Anyone with leprosy was forced to leave their family, their home, and go live in this colony away from the rest of the world where other lepers dwelt. And those with more advanced cases of leprosy continually were a reminder to the others of what they had to look forward to. And whenever a leper spotted someone from the outside world, it was his or her responsibility to shout at the top of their lungs, "Unclean, unclean!" to let others know a leper was in the vicinity. What a humiliating reminder. That individual didn't fit in with the rest of the world. And those without leprosy would walk all the way around to avoid getting near them. I share that with you because we have recorded in Matthew chapter 8, a leper who comes to Jesus, kneels before Jesus in worship and says, "If you want to, if you are willing, you can make me clean." Jesus reached out His hand and touched him. That's something you didn't do with lepers. You avoided them at all costs. But Jesus reached out and touched this leper, and Jesus said, "I am willing, be healed." And instantly, he was. Jesus' promise to that leper and His promise to you and I is this: keep on asking, and you will receive what you ask for. Keep on looking, and you will find what you are searching for. Keep on knocking, and the door will be opened. For everyone who asks receives. Everyone who looks finds. Everyone who knocks, the door will be opened. Jesus said, if your children ask you for a loaf of bread to eat, which of you would give him a stone instead? Or if your children ask for fish to eat, which of you would give them a snake instead? If you sinful people know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give good gifts to those who ask Him? I mean, every one of us as a parent wants to do the best for our kids that we possibly can. Give them whatever we think they need. Unfortunately, because our knowledge and our wisdom is limited, sometimes we give them things they don't really need. Sometimes we allow them to do things that aren't really good for them. But God knows the difference between our wants and our needs. And God is not only able to give us what we need, God is wanting to give us what we need in order for us to carry out His plans in our lives. And so while Jesus is sitting on a hillside, He motions to the sky and He says, "Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away their food in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. He takes care of them. Are you not much more valuable to Him than birds? Look at the lilies of the field. In his finest hour, Solomon did not look as good as these beautiful flowers that are laid out before your eyes. If God is willing to royally adorn fields of grass with such beauty, How much more do you suppose God wants to provide for your clothing and your physical needs and any need that you might have? The fact of the matter is, God is not only able to provide all we need to do His will, God is not only wanting to provide all we need to do His will, but God does provide all we need. Abraham was so confident that God would either provide him an animal to sacrifice there on the mountain, or that God would raise Isaac back from the dead after Abraham sacrificed him, that Abraham tells his servants, you guys wait right here. The boy and I, we're going to go on up to the mountain and we're going to worship there. And then he says, and we will return. That's faith. And when they're walking along and Isaac says, hey, Dad, here's wood. And we're carrying the fire with us, but where's the lamb? Where's the ram to sacrifice? And Abraham says, the Lord will provide. And sure enough, you know, there was at some point Abraham had to break the news to Isaac that he was the sacrifice. At some point, Abraham raised the knife to sacrifice Isaac, and in that moment, God stopped Abraham. And when he looked up, he saw a ram with its horns caught in a nearby bush. So Abraham named that place, the Lord will provide. And here's the neat thing. As we go through the Bible this year, we're going to see this story played out over and over again. Because God is able to provide what is needed to fulfill His plans. God is wanting to provide what is needed. And God does provide everything that we need in order to fulfill His plans in our lives. I'm reminded of Gideon's army in Judges chapter 7. Numbered 32,000, and God whittled that down to 300 soldiers. 300 Israelite soldiers, empowered by God, were able to defeat 135,000 Midianite soldiers. The Apostle Paul wrote in Philippians 4, verse 19, the God who takes care of all my needs is the same God who will supply all of your needs according to His glorious riches in Christ Jesus. You know, unfortunately, a lot of us, we want to go through life with no pain, no discomfort, no problems, no hardships. Jesus said that as long as we live in this world, we will have trials. That's just the way it is. It's a fallen world. We will experience sorrow. We may not always get what we want, but our God always knows what we need. And the more we trust Him, the more our attitudes change and we understand that everything God does provide for us is everything that we really need. There's a reason Jesus called Himself the Good Shepherd. There's a reason the writers of the New Testament called Jesus the Great Shepherd, the Head Shepherd, and said that we should entrust ourselves to this Shepherd. David gave that reason in Psalm 23, verse 1. Very simply, very eloquently, David says, the Lord is my shepherd. I have everything I need. Now you got to understand, sheep, they're not predatory animals. They're not the type with killer instincts that can defend themselves. They are totally dependent upon the shepherds for their protection and their provision and their guidance. And what was true of them is true of us. We are totally dependent upon the shepherd, the great shepherd, the good shepherd, for our protection, our provision, and our guidance. I don't know if you've ever heard of George Mueller, but I mean, just Google this guy's name. George Mueller, he lived during the 1800s. He was a prayer warrior. He was a man of, of faith. He totally trusted God, and as a result, God abundantly blessed George Mueller's 63-year ministry for the Lord. And as a means of encouraging others, as a means of giving glory to God, George Mueller kept extensive records. I mean, this guy recorded everything of how God had worked in his life. He would write down a prayer request, the date of the prayer request, and then he would write down the date that his prayer was answered. And consequently, George Mueller was able to specifically list 50,000 prayer requests that God had answered in his life, 5,000 of which God had answered the very same day he had prayed for them. Near the end of his life, George Mueller admitted reading through the entire Bible 200 times. 100 of those times while on his knees. And because he read God's word so extensively, he saw God's promises, he claimed God's promises, he prayed God's promises in his daily life. You know, George Mueller had all kinds of orphanages in England to take care of the orphans in that country. He had a Bible training school. The guy supported many missionaries. But you know, he never told anyone about his needs. He never went to any humans and said, "Hey, our orphanage needs this," or "Hey, my Bible training school has this need." Never. The only thing George Mueller did is he took all of his needs to the Lord in prayer. Wasn't anything he thought too small to pray, to come before God. I mean, and it worked. Again, keeping in mind, this guy wrote down everything. During the last year of his life, he recorded these gifts that were given to feed the thousands of orphans in England. 7,203 loaves of bread, 5,222 buns, 20 boxes of soap, 9 tons of coal, 26 deer, 112 rabbits, 312 pheasants, 5 bags of oatmeal, 26 cases of oranges, 5 boxes of dates, 4,013 pounds of meat, and the list goes on and on. He estimated that through his prayers alone, over $2.5 million worth of things were donated to his orphanages and his Bible training school, and that was in the 1800s. Now, I listed on your bulletin insert four rules for Christians to live by that George Mueller had, and I tell you what, based upon his life, his faith, I think we would be wise to listen. Number one, he said, read the Bible. Oh, read the Bible and meditate upon it. He said, we come to know God through prayer and reading his word. The more we read his word, the more we know his promises, the more we're able to lift up those promises in prayer. Number two, he said, maintain an upright heart and a clear conscience. Few things more valuable in life than a clear conscience. Number three, do not shrink from trials, he said. They are opportunities for our faith to be strengthened, for our faith to grow. Number four, give God time to work. I mean, we are so impatient, are we not? If we don't get something right now, God does things in his time. So in August of 1877, George Mueller set off from England for the United States. And off the coast of Newfoundland, he's on this ship. The weather turned cold, and the ship's progress was severely slowed by this dense fog. The captain had been on the bridge for 24 hours, trying to somehow navigate through the fog. And at that time, George Mueller came up on the bridge, approached the captain, and said, "Captain, I need to tell you something." He said, "I have to be in Quebec by Saturday afternoon." Captain said, "That's impossible. Look at the weather." Mueller said, "Very well, if your ship can't take me, God's going to have to find some other way." He said, "I have never broken an appointment in 52 years of ministry. let's go down below the deck and let's pray together. Well, the captain thought he was crazy. This guy is nuts. Nevertheless, they went down below. George Mueller was the first to pray. He knelt down and he prayed. When he got done, the captain started to pray, and George Mueller put his hand on the captain's shoulder and told him to stop. He said, first of all, you don't believe that God is able to remove the fog. And secondly, you don't need to pray because God has already removed the fog. Go open the door and see. And sure enough, the captain went, opened the door, and the fog was totally gone. In fact, it's the captain who for years shared the story about what George Mueller had done. It was prayer and a knowledge of God's word that kept George Mueller free from fear, free from doubt, free from worry. He would write, "The greater the difficulties, the easier for faith. The greater the trial, the sweeter the victory." Whatever trials, whatever obstacles, whatever difficulties you are facing right now or that you may face in the future, know this: God is able to provide for all of your needs. God is wanting to provide for all of your needs. And God does provide for all of your needs in order for you to do His will. Because God is on our side.